safari, and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's been a day of beautiful African rain and blessings. This is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
We're coming to you live from the great Kruger National Park, the western fringes thereof, and we've had a day of magnificent rain, and you can see a little bit of lovely greenery all over the place now, and that's going to sprout even more. Now, my name is James Hendry, and David is on camera today, and the most important part of the live safari today is you, and we'd love to hear from you. Hashtag Safari Live is the best way to get hold of us. I'm going to be talking to you from the magnificence of the safari tent. This is my office. It's where I live. I don't actually live here, in fact, but I do spend a lot of time here. We'll be using a microscope and we'll be looking at various other special things from here. Now, out in the field today, Jamie Patterson, the ultimately elegant antelope, is driving around, as is Brent Leo Smith, affianced to the elegant antelope, irascible, highly unpredictable, and then Stefan Winterboer, the calm. A mixture between Jean-Claude Van Damme and Kojak is going to be discovering the smaller things on foot and perhaps one or two bigger things if he finds the tracks there. We're going to head straight across to Jamie now, who's got one of the magnificent avifauna of this special piece of land thing. But.
And a very good afternoon to you all, and welcome on our cold and cloudy sunset safari, starting off with a bit of a surprise this afternoon. My name is Jamie. I have the brilliant Bryan on camera with me. Ah, I see the thumb's out of bed this afternoon, Bryan. This morning the thumb took the morning off in the rain and decided to hide away. I said that we've started off with a surprise because I have to confess, the last thing I expected when I came around the corner was to see a marabou stork. I haven't seen a marabou stork in ages, and it seems as though it's actually managed to find a bit of carcass, which is a surprise because we had absolutely no idea that there was any kill anywhere in this vicinity. And we drove past here this morning, so I don't quite know how we missed this. But simply, of course, we've been treated to sightings of woodland kingfisher and shiny lurie cuckoos and shiny bee eaters. Now, this marabou stork is not really high up there in terms of looks, but it is a very, very useful and actually essential bird in terms of performing the cleanup service for the African bush. It's fascinating. I'm very surprised to see it here. Something I might even call in for some of the guests that might want to come and see this. It's not often we get a chance to see them. Sometimes we see them in flocks together around the dams, but it's lovely to see one flying about and scavenging, looking a little bit scruffy and actually rather cold, all hunched up and keeping a close eye on us. And you can just see what looks like the end of an impala. I wonder what we missed, Bryan, because that's not that old. I wonder where on earth that was and where it's been hiding. There we go, we've got a fantastic opportunity to closely examine. Yes. A face perhaps only a mother marabou could love, with its patchy skin, absolutely enormous bill. This is the largest of our storks, just in terms, especially in terms of beak size. None of the other storks can match it. Very solid, clearly built for tearing away bits of carcass and small bits of bone. You can see the nictitating membrane. If you look closely as it moves across the eye, keeping it clean and free of dust. Not one of the winners of, it's part of the ugly seven, because obviously not content with just having the big five, the tourism industry has come up with all sorts of exciting different collections of animals, the secret six and the little five, or the small five, and the ugly seven. And I have to say that I think that the marabou falls quite high up on that list. A list that includes, somewhat unfairly I think, warthogs, wildebeest, Leopard-faced vultures, I've forgotten the rest, somebody help me. Marabou stork. Hyena, spotted hyena, which is grossly unfair. Just because they like to scavenge off carcasses doesn't mean that they are belong in the ugly seven. I can't remember the rest. Marabou, leopard-faced, wildebeest, spotted hyena, warthog. I'm missing two. I'm missing two. What am I doing? Is it the ugly five? No, it's the ugly seven. Right, I've lost my mind completely. It is the ugly. Is it the ugly five? Is it the ugly five? It is the ugly five. Okay, I feel a lot better about myself now, sort of. I don't know where I pulled the number seven from. It's the ugly five. There we go. A part of the ugly five with its downy head of feathers on the top of its head. Much like the vulture, needs a bald face to make sure it doesn't gather muck and bacteria. Right, well, I think it's time for us to leave our surprise Marabou stork sighting. In the meantime, it's not just ourselves in the vehicle. Stef is out on foot. Let's head across to him so that he can say good afternoon.
To the bushwalk part of this PM safari today. Jamie Quartet, I am Stef Winterboer. On camera today, we have Jean-Dre, and yes, you heard us right. We are on foot, walking around exactly the same area that Brent and Jamie are driving around in. What are we doing out here on foot? Well, you know, bushwalking or walking around in the bush, exploring Africa on foot, is really how Africa was sort of unlocked and opened. That and on horseback. And while I'd say that horseback safaris are probably close to the vehicle safaris than what we are doing at the moment, is definitely a really awesome way of unlocking different things. In the car, you can expect that over the course of the drive and these safaris, we're going to get very close to animals. Not the case on foot. But what we are going to do is unlock the things in the bush. We can go on a bit of adventure and see what is living inside a termite. What is underneath a stump? What's underneath some bark? What tricks can we pull for you out of the bush? You know, how do you make the bush? How did the settlers in this area use the bush to their advantage, especially in this particular area? That's what we're going to be doing in the next couple of hours with you over here, hopefully. I normally get sidetracked with these type of things, to be honest with you, but hopefully today I managed to do all that. Now, while we're walking around over here, it's always a good idea to keep your eyes wide open. This is the end, or the very end of spring, very beginning of our summertime. Around almost every bush, you can expect to see something. Not as concentrated as it was during the dry season over here. All these animals have dispersed quite nicely around us at the moment, but you never know what you can expect over here. So it's always a good idea to keep a weather eye open. Now, don't forget that I am just as interactive as what Brent and Jamie are. So you can ask me questions via our final control through the hashtag SafariLive and through the email address questions@WildEarthTV. Now, we are going to send you over to Jamie to go and see what she's doing. But don't stop watching, because when you come back, or at some point during the show, I'm going to show you what I'm going to use these funny shaped sticks for. See you in a little bit.
Welcome to the middle of the African bush. My name is Brett Darrow-Smith. I have Desmond on camera. And in this very area, in the pouring rain this morning, I was outfoxed by a male lion. And I don't like being outfoxed by lions. I like finding lions. So that's what we're doing. So he walked on top of my tracks here. I'd driven here. I must have missed him by about 5 minutes. Now, what I'm hoping is that he's hunkered down as the rain got harder, and being a male lion, they sleep for about 20 hours a day. He's snoozing somewhere close, and hopefully we're going to be able to find him. Now remember, this is 100% live, so you are enjoying the cloudy African bush at the exact same time as us. And if you want to ask me a question about how do you track a lion or anything like that, please do so. Use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And we will hopefully be able to show you as we go through the show how we track a lion. Very difficult after the rain. Of course, those tracks are obliterated. So now what I'm doing at the moment is I'm getting into the lion's brain. If I was a big male lion and it was raining hard, what would I do? Where would I go? Hopefully, My lion brain is on form today, and we'll be able to find him. Unlikely that he's going to go down towards the east of us. There's a dry riverbed there, and while it was raining hard, the water's likely to pool. So I think he's up here somewhere. He would have moved up to the crest where there's less likely to be water pooling. Maybe found a nice bush that was had to the south of him, so he protected from the majority of that rain coming from the southwest. I think he's having a snooze somewhere very close by here, so fingers crossed. Now this is one of the Birmingham boys, I'm pretty sure. Now that's a coalition of four male lions that dominate over three prides in this area, and I'm hoping we're going to find him not snoozing but on the move, or even better, declaring whose land is it by roaring. But of course, it's not always about all the big cats. There's lots of other fascinating creatures out here, and we're definitely going to see quite a few of them. And we've got such a variety of different ways to show you the African bush. There's two of us out on vehicles. And speaking of some of the different creatures out here, Jamie on the other car has got something to show you.
Now we've been having some serious success with birds this afternoon. First our marabou stork, and now a bird that is a European roller and a recent arrival to, well, by then, the recent arrival to our South African shores. Hold on a minute, because you horrible bird. Oh, have you still got it there, Bryan? Well done. Tuk, 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 tuk. Here we go. They have just returned, as their name suggests, from a massively long migration all the way from Europe down to South Africa. And as a result, are looking less sleek than their resident counterparts, things like lilac-breasted rollers and purple rollers. Nevertheless, a welcome arrival, and perhaps for some of you that are new to these live safaris, a new addition to your bird lists. We've only recently started seeing them, and I think we've only had them on camera a couple of times. Now, lovely to add, for those of you that are new to these safaris, we always encourage our viewers to keep a bird list. For no particular purpose, it's not a competition, it's just an interesting way of keeping track of the different birds that you can see. And I'm sure this particular European roller, despite the fact that it's a little bit damp and a little bit ruffled, is feeling thoroughly grateful for the soaking rain that we experienced this morning. It was really soaking, wasn't it, Bryan? We were soaking, weren't we, Bryan? I was most definitely soaking. But what it has done is it has brought out endless streams of reproductive members of the termite communities known as alates. And they have been fluttering around. Bryan ate one this morning by mistake. He just accidentally swallowed it. And that's something that we discussed at length on our sunrise safari. James looked at them under the microscope, and it seemed as though we couldn't move without encountering one. And that is what this European roller is after. This termite mound that is currently hidden behind the trees, I think, is active, and probably one that has just experienced a termite reproductive explosion. All of the winged members popping out. Most of them, a huge percentage of them, probably, I don't know what the exact percentage is, but probably around 99% of those termites become food for something else. For the different birds, we're seeing lots of eagles at the moment, all on the ground feeding off termites, frogs, snakes, a procession of animals. I've even seen leopards on occasion licking up the dead alates around termite mounds. So it is a very, very important time of year for all of our animals, because it does mean that they get such a boon in terms of a food source. There we go. So Rashida is keeping a bird list, and she's new to our live safaris, and she is on number 12. Well done, Rashida, and thank you for sending that through. Hopefully we will be able to add 13, 14, 15, and who knows what else to your list this afternoon. There's so much else to see in this area. I can't wait to show you the beautiful birds that you will have to add. We're going to continue on. In the meantime, let's pop over to a quarantine to the tent and see what James has to say.
I have a very strange myriapod. Now, of course, the myriapod is possibly not a word that you use in your everyday language around the table, but it is a word that we use here in the tent, and a myriapod is a millipede. In other words, he with 1,000 feet. This one has not even close to 1,000 feet, but it comes from the same group of insects that the millipedes come from, and he's called a pill millipede. There he is. Isn't that amazing? That's him under the microscope there. And he's a gorgeous kind of green and gold and brown color. But what he's done, he's not dead. I know he's completely immobile, but he's actually just terrified of me. I'm such a terrifying human being that the pill millipede has wrapped itself into its defensive ball, from which I do not think it will be coaxed very easily. And you can see how they are not very often eaten by things because they're so very clever at managing to hide themselves. Now, I'll take it out again. And what we have here, of course, I'm just going to quickly, I think I've lost my communications with the final controller. Oh, there they are. All right. And there, what I'm hoping it's going to do is unfold and go and look for some leaf detritus to eat, possibly not on my hand. Anyway, that's the first thing that we're going to deal with here. And I'm going to put it over there and just maybe, if it manages to come out, we'll have a look at it there. But I don't think it's going to move until we put it outside into the green. Now, of course, one of the things that will terrify every single one of you more than anything else, not snakes, not the thought of being pulled from your bed by a grizzly bear, but a spider. And that particular spider, everybody, is one of the only medically important spiders in South Africa. By medically important, of course, that is a euphemism for deeply dangerous. And it is called a violin spider on account of the fact that it has apparently some kind of violin design on its abdomen. I mean, this is obviously named by somebody who's very clearly not spent a good amount of time around violins. There we go. I don't see any violin there at all, but it is very distinctive. And what is even more terrifying and bone-chilling about this spider is that it's carrying in its jaws an egg sac, which means very shortly there are going to be many, many more little medically important violin spiders knocking about this area. And I think what we're probably going to do, she's not going to hunt or eat while she's holding that thing. So I think we're probably going to find a home for her in the tent and watch the process of how this unfolds. I think it's going to be rather fun. I'm also going to avoid being bitten by her because that will be an experience I would find deeply, deeply unpleasant. So we're going to put her in there like that. I'm going to find her a slightly more salubrious digs sometimes. Oh dear, no, hang on, I can't put it in there because I've got something else in here. Wait a second. Let me put this over here like that. There we are. Don't go anywhere, Mrs. Violin Spider. Here is a delightful little caterpillar. I'm not going to put it on my hand because it too, while not medically important, it will sting me with its hairs. Hang on, let me get that right. There we are. Oh, look at that. Isn't that gorgeous? Look at it. It's got the most astounding haircut. It looks a little bit like a St. Charles, what's they called? Prince Charles Spaniel, mixed in with a bit of worm. A cross between a worm and a Prince Charles Spaniel. And it's looking for something to eat. It eats combretum leaves, which are the bush willow, the most common leaves that we find out here. And I will put him back onto a bush willow very soon. Right, there we go. Okay. Marvellous. That is excellent. Okay, now, the other things that we have in here, of course, we're going to be having a look at a number of eggs and things, and unfortunately, one of those was squished by Jamie the other day. The remnants of it are now on this desk. We'll have to get rid of that. I'm not sure what it would have tasted like. Some astounding things that have come up during the course of the day, those are mushrooms. They're growing on some rotting wood. So we'll have a look at those in a little bit of greater detail very soon. Now, we're going to have one last look at the pill millipede and hope desperately that he comes out. And what you have to do with these things sometimes is just warm them up. This one's just gone misty. He doesn't want to come out. All right, we're going to go off to a short break now. Don't go anywhere because Brent Leo Smith will hopefully find those lions. Now, of course, that was just a practice advert break, everybody. We were just practicing because, of course, we are doing a TV show on Thursday, on the 15th, at 4 o'clock this time. Now, we're going to do a very special link across to Jamie now, and you are going to be transported onto her vehicle by air. There we are. That is Jamie's vehicle there. Connor, drone commander, is flying up over the top of her, and very shortly you will be dropped gently underneath that rain cover that she's got there, and hopefully she will show you something very interesting.
Cars or the new roof attached. I tried to say that mine was a bit like of the Batmobile, but nobody actually agreed with me. But yeah, you would have got an idea as to just how it's really going. It's such a pleasure with all of the rain that we've had, that we have had the changes and seeing. And for animals like these Impala, it has come at the perfect time. Last night they would have spent probably what would have been quite a miserable night shivering away with damp, fluffed up fur. But they're all looking perfectly comfortable now. We're going to continue on, start making our way towards a Cheetah Plains. While we do, let's head back on foot with Stef.
Now, welcome back here to us exploring around on foot here at Djuma Private Game Reserve. And this is one of my favorite beetles. This is a giant click beetle. You can see it's roughly about an inch long. And I recognized it from those two spines that occur just next to its head. And I'm going to show you what an interesting defense mechanism this particular click beetle has. What you do, you can put them like this, upside down. And watch how they can right themselves. Now, I bet you just because I wanted to show you this, that is not going to happen. So let me wait. Let me come and show you him a little bit closer. These click beetles. You get two different kinds of click beetle here. You get the giant click beetle. This one grows a little bit taller than, well, a little bit longer than he is at the moment. And then you get a one that's about half the size in every dimension. That is the acacia click beetle. Okay, so he obviously doesn't want to jump for us. They've got a mechanical click that they can produce. That is produced at the back of their head. There we go, watch him clicking, there we go. Have a look at that, and again, come on. Let's see if you put him upside down, if he'll click now. There we go, boom. Come on, click one more time. All right, let's put him on something hard and see if he'll click upright. They can bounce pretty high. Now, for most beetles, or for a lot of beetles, oops, I'm coming undone over here. Losing all my bits and pieces of kit. Okay. Let's see how high he'll actually click. Let's just watch over there and see how quickly it'll take to click around. Come on. No? Yes, they don't really bite. These particular beetles are fairly harmless. They would get shoved around quite a lot here by the larger herbivores as well. So this isn't doing him any damage whatsoever. Now, I must be honest, there's another thing happening over here that is absolutely incredible, which I'm going to go into in a second. So we're going to go back to our TV audience in a little while, and then I'll show you what I've just witnessed over here. So you'd bear with us while we get joined by our TV audience. I'm going to just tell them about this poor beetle that's lying on his back over here waiting for us to click, and then I'm going to show you what we've managed to find here as well. Very, very interesting. Can you see it yet? Can't? All right, welcome back to the bushwalk. While you've been away, we have been playing with a giant click beetle. This is a click beetle. The giant click beetle, you can see it's about an inch long, about as long as what my thumb is. And we're waiting for it to click. But what I've noticed as well is that there is a colony of drop-tail ants. That's a drop-tail ant. And they are hunting some termites. Now, what that ant was doing was stinging a termite. Now, let's see. He's going to go and fetch some more. Watch carefully here. Let's see if he fetches another one. There's all these tiny little termites all over the place here. These ants are voracious predators of these termites. Shame. The termites in this area number literally in their millions per square yard. I would say almost, is it per million per square yard? No, probably about a couple of tens of thousands per square yard, but a couple of million termites per termite mound. I'm going to show you a giant termite mound near where we're standing. This click beetle's gone to sleep, I think. There we go. There he bounces. Doesn't like me touching him. Watch how high he clicks himself. There we go. He's locked his click. There we go. And he jumped on top of his legs. You see there how he turned over? That is a click beetle. Now back to these ants. You put that click beetle down. Have a look here. There is an ant. There's one stinging there now. So what we're going to do, I'm just trying to, obviously trying to zoom you in. There we go. There's one harvesting an ant, stinging it. Now they one, they're an ant called a drop tail ant. They're highly carnivorous. I'm just trying to think of what is the, is their toxin that they've actually got. They've got one of the very rarest of the toxins. Now, that occur in the ant kingdom. In actual fact, only these ants have this particular type of poison, the drop tail ants. I'm just trying to think now in my memory what it was. In any case, if you're wondering why ants have a sting and why they have poison, it's because they belong to the insect order Hymenoptera, which includes bees and wasps, and in actual fact includes the most highly evolved insects on the planet are bees and wasps and ants. And these ants have obviously perfected the art of hunting termites. They grab the termite with their pincers, bring their tail around, sting the termite, and then I've noticed that they larder the termites. They carry the termites to a point, the immobilized termites, and wait until all the termites have gone back underground, and then they take their larded termites back to their nest. And it's primarily to feed their young. And here we've got a drop tail ant carrying a termite in his jaws, following a line of pheromones, a line of smell, right back to the ant colony. They know exactly where the ant colony is, mainly because of the smell that they pick up with their antennae on the front of their head. Now, what will be interesting to do is to follow this line of ants and see where their colony is. Now, generally, these ants love to nest at the base of a tree, and they can excavate a massive amount of sand. Now, what I'm thinking... Yeah, here we go. As predicted. Doesn't always happen like that, I promise you. I don't always predict where these ants are going to be. But here you can see the ants underneath this bush. Now these ones are dropping sand. There's one there, drops his sand and goes back again to go and excavate some more. So while you've got some that are foraging for termites, you've got other ants that are busy digging and excavating, and they're probably just cleaning out the mud in their tunnels. With the rain over the last couple of days that we had here, I would presume that some of their tunnels got flooded and some of them caved in, and that's exactly what they're busy doing over there now. There's another one. Now they've got a sting. I'm not going to touch them. I personally am allergic to ants. Oh, I'm actually, what am I saying? I'm actually allergic to bee stings, and so I don't want to get stung by an ant. I don't quite know what reaction I would have to being stung by an ant. So when I know that an ant's got a sting, I don't touch them at all. Now, what we're going to do is with these clouds that rolled over this morning, with the rain that came, we are going to practice. You saw the tents on top of the cars this morning. For those of you that were watching, we're going to practice a bushwalk tent, or a rain plan, as we like to say. So that's what I'm going to be doing while you're away from me. But when you come back to me again after however long, you're going to see that we are going to have a shelter of some sort up. Now, without further ado, I think it's a good idea to go and see what Mr. Brent Leo Smith is up to.
So we couldn't find any signs of that male lion, but that doesn't mean he's there. But if you know lion behavior, you know he's going to get moving, but probably in an hour or so. Now, yesterday evening, the whole Inkahuma pride, so six cubs, five lionesses were in this area. So now that it's stopped raining, they might have moved out of the thicket. So we're just going to have a quick loop around here before we head back towards where we think that male is. And it is always really exciting about being on a live safari, because I might be looking for lions, I could come around the corner, there could be a wild dog, there could be a cheetah. And that is the amazing thing. I mean, this is 100% live from the middle of Africa. We're approaching an area that the lions do like quite a lot. Oh, look, there's a little female Steenbokkie. Here we go. Hello, little one. Keeping very, very still. That, of course, is one of her defensive mechanisms. They do have quite a few. They live in tiny little territories of about 4 acres. And they're both browsers and grazers, so they eat grass and... Oh! You see, she suddenly turned her head to the left, and I spotted something else. Well, she's going to sneak off, and she spotted a member of the order Carnivora. A fearsome, ferocious predator that we're going to try and find around the corner. Now, of course, predators come in all different shapes and sizes. The largest member of the order Carnivora is, of course, the lion. But where did this other member of the order Carnivora go? Let me just switch off and listen for a second. Maybe I can talk to it. No, it's made a disappearing act. There were some dwarf mongoose. They could be a bit skittish. There's a lot of birds of prey out in this weather because of the termites. So the dwarf mongoose will also be feeding on the termites, but they also got to keep an eye on above. Hi, Jamie. Jamie would like to know, are lions more active at night or during the day? Well, generally during the day, but at night, I'm talking absolute nonsense there. But they can be quite active on a cool day like today. Depends on how full they are. But you must remember that all the predators out here are absolute opportunists. So if something happened to stumble onto them while they were snoozing during the day, they would go from inert to extremely active in a matter of seconds. Now, I was hoping a bit of sun might have come out. So if the sun comes out, you quite often find lions after the rain will come sort of lounge, dry off, and enjoy the sunlight, but not quite breaking through yet. So this is the area where the lions were yesterday, or the pride. I doubt they're going to be right here today, but they could be somewhere relatively close by. So always have a quick scan at the waterhole. Now, with the rain, of course, there's lots of water around, but these waterholes still attract really interesting bird species and sometimes elephants and buffalo like to wallow in them. So always good to check. But I'm going to go park up on the wall. And let's see what we can see from up here. There's also a family of Egyptian geese who had 11 goslings the last time we're here. I don't see them just yet. Okay, let's see. Ooh. Now also, there is a little wader, a water bird, in the middle of the mud there. But it looks like he's got his head ducked down. And slowly, is that him there? Just come out of it. Up there, where my finger is. Up. Here we go. So here we go, a little wader, water bird. Now, that one, we've been seeing quite a few of them. It's a little wood sandpiper. But he's got himself down into what looks like an old footprint of a hippo. And he's getting out of the wind. Now, if we come out and off to the left slightly, follow the footprints, the hippo footprints to the left. There we go. And look, look, there. See the movement? See the movement? Follow the movement right there. A little bit to the left. It's got something. It looked like it caught something. There's another little wood sandpiper. Was it just having a drink? Just having a drink. Now, interestingly, sometimes we get a bit of help from above, and our drone commander, Connor, is in the area. And I wonder what we can see from way up high. I wonder if Connor is going to help find the lions. So there we go. Hello, guys. Desmond, you can wave. You're on drone. Here we go. And as you can see, there's the water hole. It's got these two lovely little dry river systems that flow into it at the moment. Not too many mammals around, but I don't know what you guys can see from up there. And find the lions for us. Make it easy for me. Okay. Now, we're about to come over as high, guys. Heading towards the waterhole. Now, drones on Safari Live and waterholes have had some interesting times in the past. One spectacularly crashed at the Djuma waterhole once. And you can see the clouds rolling in from the east. There is a bit of, and you can see a bit of blue sky just now and then through the gap. Now, of course, the other thing that the drones have to watch out for is occasionally they are attacked by birds of prey who take offense, think it's something trying to muscle in on their territory. Isn't that great, eh? And so we're able to jump up into the sky. You're with us here on the ground, and Steph on foot. Oh, there's some big terrapin movement down there. Are you running or chasing another terrapin? Ferocious little aquatic predators, the different terrapin species. That looked like a little serrated hinge terrapin. We do get marsh terrapin as well. But they will be absolutely ecstatic with the rain. And what I love about this time of the year is if you look carefully in a lot of the puddles, often you can find tiny, tiny little terrapins. I mean, the size, not much bigger than my thumb. Okay, so we've had a good look around here. I don't see anything. No sign of those lions. Oh, but there's a beautiful bird. So on that tambourgi tree, bottom, if you take the fork, you got him? Or do you need me to... There. There we go. You can see the electric blue of the Woodland's Kingfisher. Now, even though we are next to a waterhole, it's a kingfisher that doesn't eat fish. It is an insectivorous kingfisher. Yeah, giving its beak a clean. You will see them dunk into water holes when it's hot to cool off, but mostly they perch and hunt from a perch just like that. Grasshoppers, frogs, lizards, and lots of other insects. They nest here and they migrate from Central Africa, or Central and North Africa, all the way up to Mauritania and Senegal. So they are in perpetual summer. They spend North Africa's winter months in South Africa and South Africa's winter months in North Africa. Off he goes. Now, we're about to keep on moving. Hopefully, we're going to be able to find something else. We are about to go into a little break, and so if you need a drink, a cup of coffee, we suggest you do that. Remember, we're still on the hunt for the largest carnivore in Africa, the lion, and you never know what could be around the next corner. It could be elephants, and Stef is still making his tent, so join us without further ado after the break for the rest of Safari Live. And we are in the ad break. Desmond, what do you want to sell on the ad break?
What do I want to sell?
What do you want to sell? It's an ad break. Sell something. Come, sell something. Shame, I think Desmond's a bit... Come on, Desmond! He's a bit nervous.
New telescopes and binoculars and rangefinders.
There we go. He wants to say, we're going to sell telescopes, binoculars and rangefinders. If you want one, go dig in the mud in Biffleshook Dam. Hopefully there will be one for free. I wouldn't recommend it, though. Quite smelly down there. Hello, Matthew. Matthew is wondering, why don't Woodland's kingfishers eat fish? Well, because there was probably too much competition, Matthew. So your pescivorian kingfishers, your pied kingfisher, and the giant kingfisher have sort of, in this part of Africa, they've evolved and they really dominate that medium to large kingfisher size across the water bodies of Africa. So you probably find, or the main reason that they would have evolved from eating fish to eating insects and even little snakes and other things, is there's a lot more food availability away from the water. There's a lot more areas where there's no rivers, there's no water holes. So they would have evolved to find a food niche or a food surplus that they're not in too much competition with. And that's probably the reason your Woodlands, brown hooded, striped, pygmy, all are insectivorous kingfishers rather than pescivorian kingfishers. So if you look at the different kingfisher species, your giant's the biggest, so that really dominates the fishing, followed by your pied, and then the small, tiny malachite dominates from the smaller side. So the pygmy and malachite would be in competition, and then the Woodlands, brown hooded and striped and all that would be in competition with the giant and pied. So they've just diversified to make sure they all get enough food, is probably the main reason why they evolved those separate evolutions. But while we continue to look for the incredible incahuamans and anything else that might be around the corner, let's go to the highly entertaining James Henry in the tent.
Not in the tent anymore, of course, and we are in fake advert break, so we're going to give you an indication of what is out here as a result of the rain. That, believe it or not, is a grasshopper. And it is probably an instar from a grasshopper, which means that it's a junior grasshopper, it's not an adult. Isn't he cool? He's trying to pretend that he's not that upset to be caught by me. He is, in fact, very upset. He doesn't want to be caught at all. But I'm holding his back legs, which makes him unable to hop. I think he's a marvellous fellow. I'm not sure exactly which grasshopper he is. I'll have to head through the books to find out. But perhaps one of the grasshoppers called Thericles grasshoppers, but I'm not entirely sure. Now, an instar, for those of you who don't know, is the sort of junior form of something like a grasshopper or a mantis, which doesn't go through metamorphosis. So they have what we call a hemi-metabolic life cycle. And that means they don't go through the complete metamorphosis that, say, a butterfly goes through. That's called holometabolic. You don't have to remember that, of course. But holometabolic means it goes from a completely unrecognizable larval form, so a caterpillar, and then it goes into a pupa and becomes mush, basically, and then reforms into a butterfly. And it's one of the great mysteries of biology that we still don't quite understand. This thing, with its hemi-metabolic life cycle, like many of the bugs — bug, of course, is a biological term, it's not a term that has anything to do with the sort of general creepy crawlies — but they don't go through larval stages either. They, like these, go through instars, which resemble the adults, but they often don't have wings where the adults are winged. Right, shall we put him down? Then, the other thing I just wanted to show you before we go back to the fake TV audience is here. We have some beautiful, beautiful evidence of the African rain that we had this morning. Isn't that lovely? See how this grass has caught the crystalline hydrogen and oxygen atoms melded together into a water droplet on top of a piece of grass. Isn't that lovely? I really think that's quite splendid, especially given the drought that we've had. And if I was a thirsty beetle, I might come along here and have a little drink of it. Right, we're going back to television, everybody. Let me get up. Clean myself off. Can't be lying on the floor for television. Right. Now, because we're going back to fake TV, I'm not really going to draw on this because we have a limited number. 10 seconds, everyone. Are you ready? Don't be nervous. We'll be okay. Right, welcome back, everybody, to your safari. Brent Leo Smith is still out there looking for the lions. Steph is setting up his rain bivouac, and Jamie Patterson is scouring the landscape for other interesting things. I'll show you a little bit about where they are, and then I'll show you a little bit about what Brent was looking for earlier. Brent is around Biffle's Hook Dam there in the northeast corner of Djuma. That's where we are now. Jamie is around that point there, scouring the landscape, perhaps for elephants in that area, and Stefan is about to form his bivouac over there. Jamie is in fact not over there at all. She is down here on Cheetah Plains. My GPS, I'm afraid, lied to me. Beast Lily. Anyway, she's down in the far southeast. So we've got a great spread of people scouring the landscape for interesting things. Now, Brent Leo Smith earlier on was looking for a dwarf mongoose. Now, a dwarf mongoose is very closely related to what I'm showing you here. This is a genet skull, and a genet comes from a slightly different family from the mongoose, but very similar. And what they are kind of omnivorous carnivores, if you like. And we know that they're slightly omnivorous by the fact that if you look into the mouth here, you can see that the molars actually have some flat chewing surfaces on them. Now, if you were a carnivore like a lion, those flat chewing surfaces simply do not exist. And that's because they eat only meat and bone and that sort of thing. Whereas something like a genet and the mongoose, yes, it absolutely is part of the order Carnivora. It will eat largely meat, but they will also eat some fruits if they have to. They'll have to eat spiders and termites as well, but they don't mind doing that. I personally am very glad that I don't have to eat spiders and termites. Oh, now that's quite interesting. I think you were asking Virginia if we have something similar to a skunk or a polecat. We do actually. If you come back into the tent with us here, we have something that is part of the same family. They are part of the family Mustelidae, and the Mustelidae, or the Mustelids, are a very, very special representative who lives here at Djuma. And he is over here. Now, Virginia, I don't know if you were on safari with us this morning, but we were discussing this very fine fellow. He is, of course, the honey badger. There he is. And what we were discussing, Virginia, about this fellow, I mean, well, let's compare the dentition. He is also, although a carnivore, he is also slightly sort of omnivorous. He will eat things other than just plain meat, so that's why he's got flattened molars at the back there. But the most remarkable thing about the honey badger skull is the immense size of the brain. He has proportionately by far the biggest brain of any carnivore proportionately that I've ever seen out here, and they are known problem solvers. And isn't it astounding that problem solving, which has perhaps helped to contribute to make our brain so big, has done the same, and very unusually so, in this wonderful mustelid, the honey badger. Right, Stefan Winterboer, I showed you where he is on the map. He's setting up his rain bivouac. Let's go and find out how that's going.
And you get me busy doing the final touches on a peg that I want to use to secure the back of my tarpaulin, which is in the background there. We've got it up, positioned it nicely against the wind, and I used my ash bag for that. So this is one for light rain. This is a tarpaulin design for light rain, sort of like we had this morning, not for torrential downpours. That'll be a different tarpaulin design. This one is designed to give you a little bit of view out the one side. It'll give you access to fire, let you move in and out, but will give you cover from rain falling down and rain from the back. And as you can see, what I've done is it's a very basic design, but what I'm going to do now is just go and secure the back with a few more pegs. So come with me. Picked up my trusty hammer. You get them all over the place. It's quite a nice DIY store. Talking about DIY, we're going to use this in a little bit. This is the snail shell from a giant land snail. It's got some holes in, so no, we're not going to be able to use that one. It's got too many holes in it. And now what I want to go and do is I want to just secure the back of my tarpaulin with a few more of these pegs. Now you can use sand, you can pile sand on here to give it even more rigidity if you'd like, but I find these ones with all these little eye holes in it to be just as effective. What I'm looking for now is just one more peg, one that'll fit through there. So obviously we head to our nearest square stemmed raisin bush and we go and that comes from here. These bushes make most unbelievably good 10 peg trees. I'll show you one now. There's one right here. This one's probably going to be a bit flimsy, but you can see the straight edges that it gets. Very, very nice for making tent pegs. So let us look for a nice one. You want to be able to hammer it into the ground without it breaking, but you don't want it so rigid that if it hits a stone, it will snap. These dead ones tend to be okay. Also be okay when we get there. Luckily for me, the ground is fairly soft. So let's go see what this does. Now we're just gonna, right, got these little ridge on it. Just gonna stick it in there. No, I broke it. Too hasty, she cries. Shows you, you know, instead of just doing it properly the first time round. Alright, come with me. Let's go and look for a proper peg. I'll show you how we do it. It's actually quite a nice campsite, this. Let's have a look at it from this side. Have a look over there, Mr. Gendre. Got a nice tree, an apple leaf tree, and we've got an ivory tree in the background. Ah, lots of dead wood around. It is very nice. All right. Now, why are we practicing this? Why are we practicing making one of these rain shelters? Well, quite simply, it is because we don't quite know what conditions we're going to have over here over the next couple of in the next couple of days. And with TV happening on Thursday, which is the 15th Central Africa time, 4 to 6 o'clock, we just want to make sure that we don't have to come back if it starts raining, that we can actually do a show, a TV show, from the comfort or relative comfort of one of these tarpaulin shelters. And hopefully we'll be able to bring you a show even if it's pouring down in the rain. Now, while I figure out how I'm going to secure that last little peg in that site, and then I'm going to get a fire going hopefully, and I've got a bit of a surprise for Gendre in my backpack, why don't we go see what Jamie's up to at Cheetah Plains.
Traveling all the way across from Djuma right to Cheetah Plains and nearly at, the boundary of the Greater Kruger National Park. Bryan and myself have trundled all the way here in the hope that we might find some big cats. Now Brent has been searching for that male lion from this morning, or at least I believe he's still searching for that male lion from this morning. Tent is currently building a Stef in order to shelter himself from the rain. Stef is currently building himself a tent in order to shelter himself from the rain. Luckily, Bryan and myself should be fine, although the weather's been quite nice. It's just starting to clear up. We'd show you, but we can't because there's a roof over our heads. But there are patches of blue sky coming through. And so far we've seen, what have we seen, Bryan? Some Impala. Yes. Haven't seen anything since the Impala. No. Everything is hiding away. So I went and I checked Djuma Dam to see whether or not there was any sign of the Styx pride, particularly the Styx female with her two cubs. And we've only really seen them twice, and they're utterly adorable. The newest arrivals in terms of lion cubs that we will see. And they're still at that fluffy teddy bear-like stage. I was hoping that she might still be keeping them in that area, but it doesn't look like it. And so, going to go all the way to the open area. Maybe we'll see a baby wildebeest or two. Now, Jamie, you were wondering about how you track lions. Jamie, to be completely honest with you, from one Jamie to another, it's very difficult to track a day like today. Brent this morning... Oh, it was Janie with an F. Kirst, I don't know if you realize how similar N and M sound, especially these radios. Is that an N or an M? Oh dear, it seems as though we've got to carry on. So what we'll do, we'll send you across to Brent and he can tell you how to track lions.
Well, you don't track lions how we're doing it at the moment. Firstly, you've got to start with the track. So we're guessing at the moment, and hopefully our guesses come to fruition. But we will keep trying, and I think we're going to have a bit better luck as it gets a little bit later. I'm going to head back into the area where I know there was a male lion this morning. Hopefully he decides to extend his ample vocal cords into a big roar to let us know exactly where he is. Otherwise he might get moving probably in the next 45 minutes or so. So I've just decided to take a nice general drive through Djuma, see how much rain, because out here in the African bush you can get a lot more rain in one little section than the other. So just to have a look how localized the rain was this morning, see if there's any interesting things that the rain could have caused. Very often, I mean, you can hear massive branches falling, dead branches on things like marulas. As they get soaked with rain, they collapse out of the tree. Debbie in Vancouver. Debbie would like to look at some puddles. She says she'd love to see some water insects. Well, I'll keep my eyes open, Debbie. I will. Hopefully we will find some aquatic creatures, water insects and frogs, hopefully. And there's a lot of the puddles now straight after the rain are not going to have anything in them. It's a bit early for a lot of them. So there's some that had water for a bit longer. Those are the ones we need to check in. Of course, the one thing that we have been missing since the rain is the elephants. Now, of course, this is natural behavior for the elephants to spread out and move away as the rain falls and different areas become better feeding zones. What we can hope is we're going to have a good marula season, which will bring all of them back in January and February. Now, of course, there was going to be a lovely insect boom after the rain. And speaking of six-legged creatures, it seems like James has found some near his tent.
I warn you, everybody. This is an age-restricted sighting. If you are a young viewer, beware. What we have here is two grasshoppers in the process of making other grasshoppers. Isn't that amazing? That's the little male on top. That's the female underneath. And their bottoms are touching. So the transfer of sperm to the eggs of the grasshopper female is taking place. That is just a fantastic shot. Oh, here they are. Don't go anywhere, come on now. Now she is, of course, carrying him with her as they go. Hello, don't mind us, just carry on as you were. Pretend we are not here. We're studying you. Yes, we are, good. There, now you see they don't think we're watching them anymore. But isn't that amazing? And so she will go and lay some eggs, and out of them will come, of course, those little grasshopperlings, or instars that we saw earlier. And think, in fact, in grasshoppers, they're known as hoppers, which is a very appropriate name for them. And the rain, which Brent has been talking about and Jamie's been talking about, and of course Steph is trying to avoid, has brought out all of these amazing creatures. We've had great termite emergences, we've had grasshoppers, we've had pill millipedes, we've had all sorts of frogs coming out to try and eat the insects that have come out of here. So really we've had a wonderful boon insect time, as Brent mentioned. Right, so I think we're going to leave them to themselves, David. They clearly are feeling slightly self-conscious about the reactivity that they're engaged in right now. Now, I think that there is quite an interesting picture going on from the air. So let's go and take a look. There is the drone picture. Drone Commander Connor Teagues is in the air. And what I would like to say about this picture that he's taking is that even though only yesterday we had, or in fact only this morning we had rain, I already think that it's looking slightly greener. Don't you think that? It might be the fact, of course, also that there is, well, that sort of covering of cloud, which of course is changing the colour. Right, now what we're going to do is head across to the Djuma Dam. We're going past the mast on the left-hand side of your screen, which is where the signal that you're currently receiving us on is coming from. Now what's interesting there, as we go over the top of that clearing, we can see some green grass under the trees. And in that area there that we're over, that's artificially cleared. And it's interesting because it's obviously inspired a lot of animal activity, and those animals have therefore clearly grazed it almost flat. That's totally normal. And there we can see the Djuma Dam. Isn't that an amazing picture? So that's the Djuma Dam, where we've had such joy with the elephants in the heat and the warthogs coming to wallow and the Nyala and the Impala coming down at various times of the day. And don't worry, the dam camera will be up and going fairly soon. So I just think that's a really nice picture of the dam from the top. And the drainage line that you can see then heading off to the south of the dam, that's south where it's turning now, heads into the Mluamati drainage, which comes out of Biffle's Hook, and then eventually, I think, flows straight into the Sand River. Now we've come sort of full 360, and what you can see there, of course, is the weather coming in from all angles. And I'm hoping that we're going to have a little bit more rain today, and that it will be a bright, sparkly morning tomorrow. And when all of those clearings, of course, will turn into, as soon as the sun hits them. They're too Nyala. Look, look, look. Down in the bottom left. Don't stop, Connor. Come back, come back. And reverse. Oh, dear. No, he's coming back. I suspect. No. Oh, there we are. This is just so wonderful. There's some Nyala bulls. Two or three Nyala bulls. And they will not be able to hear this thing now because it is seriously high up in the sky, so they're hardly noticing the drone at all. And I wonder if we can't befall on the drone commander to go just a little bit lower and see if they how they react. There he comes, the three of them there. I've seen lots of groups of Nyala bull of late, and I think they're just trying to exclude themselves from the nursery herds where the females and the babies are. A bit like sort of bachelors heading off to the bar after a long day with the family. There they are. Look, they're not reacting at all. And what they're seeking out there are the green forbs underneath the shade of those trees. And that's going to keep them sustained, of course, after what has been a tremendously nasty drought. And the extent of the drought is really not apparent anymore when you are on drive. But when you start looking at things from this angle, you can see the extent of the drought. You can see the skeletons of the trees that the elephants have pushed over. Countless knobthorns, cambretum trees, and marulas during the dry season. They've pushed them all over, eaten the foliage, and they're now lying like skeletons on almost barren land, it looks like. Get a bit closer to the ground, and absolutely we can see that there's a little bit of green growth there. But that, this time last year, would have looked substantially different. It would have been carpeted in a much more emerald sheen. than it has right now. So lovely, those nyalas. Beautiful. Wasn't that special? I just think that is a wonderful way to experience the wilderness. Now, our grasshoppers have absconded, I'm afraid, but there is something else I want to show you. There. Oh. That was interesting. I didn't realise that Jamie was quite that small. It was quite a nice view of her, I thought, under the microscope there. Well, she's been replaced by a little spider that is coming out of, I think, what is probably an egg sac. It's probably a spiderling, a little baby spider, and I think it might have some friends inside, some siblings. And this little egg sac is sitting sort of on a stalk on the end of a tambwirti leaf. And he's just starting to emerge. And in fact, you know what? This isn't the first one. The first one has come out and gone away. This is the second one coming out of this little egg sac. Isn't that cool? Now, if I pull it out, I'm going to just pull it out of here. Let me just move this up slightly. I'll show it to you. You must appreciate how very, 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 very tiny this is. Look at that. It's about 2 millimeters across, the egg sac, and the spider itself is less than a millimeter long. You can just see it on the end there. How cool is that, everyone? Tiny little spider. Well, one of the things you, of course, never want to find when you're camping and trying to find yourself a warm, safe, dry spot to sit in the rain is a spider. Stef is setting up a tent, and let's see if there are any spiders in it.
That's it. You're having a look at possibly one of the most difficult things that there is to do when you're out here and there's imminent rain, and or there has been a lot of rain in the area, and that is to find enough dry material to light a fire with. Now what I've done is I've gone and scratched, literally been scraping the top of every dry piece of elephant dung I can find to get just the bits of air-dried material that are on the top of this elephant dung. And I have collected that right here. Another thing I've got is I've got a handful of tinder, which is a bunch of dry sticks, gradually getting bigger in size all the way to the stumps that would be a little bit easier to take. Now I have a variety of different fire-making tools. We can, of course, use a spark from a flint, which I can try in this case, but I think this is going to be very difficult to do. Now, Tucker, who's only 4 years old, hello Tucker, you've asked, am I going to spend the night in my tent? Tucker, no, not tonight, although I would dearly love to spend the night in my tent. Wouldn't you like to spend a night in there? I think I'd be dragging a bit of bushes out to either side, probably redesign it a little bit so that I don't feel as exposed, but I could spend the night in there, hey? Couldn't you? Jean-André just nodding his head, yes, right. But I think rather than sparks, I'm going to go to my trusted sort of chemical fire starters. This is basically an antiseptic that you use as a fungicide in your... You can bathe your feet in it, you can bathe a wound in it. People living in areas where snow occurs can use this as an SOS in the snow. It's called potassium permanganate or Condy's crystals, something that is fairly common in all first aid kits, or should be at least anyway, out here. This is glycerine, which is used as a moisturizer. And when you've got a bald head like I have, putting a little bit of this trusted material on your head to help with sunburn is just fantastic. Glycerine, what it does is it actually draws a lot of moisture out from deeper in the skin and will moisturize burnt areas. And if you like me, can also aid you as an SOS beacon to flash at a passing helicopter if you really need to. All right, now apart from making my head nice and shiny, we just add 1, 2, 3 drops. Let's see, maybe a fourth one just for luck. Let's see how quickly if this is going to work. It's always a little bit of an iffy thing, this, because the temperature is quite cold. Let's see, come on, are you going to do it? No, yes. Is today your day? There we go, starting to smoke. Come on, come on, come on. You can do it. Burn, burn, burn. There we go. Okay, now let's hope that that was hot enough to start my elephant dung smoldering. Now I'm going to put a few sticks over the top, like that, and I'm going to burn, blow. Much smoke, no flame just yet. And I'm run out of classic amateur hour here. I've run out of kindling. I'm gonna have to go and find some more elephant dung. This is live, don't forget. I don't script this, or this is not scripted. I'm doing this as you watching it. And it is a bit difficult to get going, but while I get this thing going, hopefully when you get back, I'll have a fire here. Why don't you go and see what Brent's got?
And here we go. Probably one of the only raptors that's not so happy with the cold weather. Of course, all the eagles have been feasting upon termites, but the vultures, they will eat termites, but not too often. They prefer it when it's hot and clear, and they can ride the hot, windy thermals up into the sky to look for carrion. So there's a very unhappy-looking white-backed vulture sitting upon a dead leadwood tree. And I suppose the vultures can't complain. They've had a very festive dry season with lots of carcasses to choose from. And it is nice to see one, even if it isn't looking too happy. In extreme cases, vultures will hunt themselves, but the only species that have really been recorded doing it are white-headed and lappet-faced. Whiteback's almost exclusively a carrion eater. I have seen them eat termites before, but as I said, it is quite unusual. Okay, Mr. Vulture. Now, in other news, we found another set of lion tracks. So Steph was saying he thought there was also a lion that was somewhere down towards the south, and we found another set of tracks sort of towards the end of the rain, of another male lion coming this way. So the last tracks crossed the Mawati River, so we're just coming down now from the treehouse area, making sure he didn't come this way. And of course, this area is always a good spot to look for our favorite Queen Karula and Hosana and Shongile. It is being a little bit quiet so far, which is a little bit expected after the rain, but oh, there's another raptor. Oh no, he's gone, sorry, he's flown off. Let's see if he lands. It's a common buzzard, used to be called a steppe buzzard. But is he going to land? Is he going to land? Is he going to land? No, he's not. Disappearing off into the horizon. Hopefully we found a big male lion snoozing on his back at Twin Dams. Now this area has been a firm favorite for Karula and the cubs over the last 2 months. Now of course, always very important when it comes to finding animals, your ears often find things before. So I'm going to sit here and listen quietly for a few seconds. Maybe I'll hear an alarm call. While we do that, let's go see what's happening in the Far East with Jamie.
Much like Brent, we are sitting quietly and listening. In this case, not for the alarm calls, but for the call of this particular bird known as a black-bellied bustard. And I think it is a favorite for many of us around here, just because it has one of the most unique calls of any of the birds. And this big one, has just flown away from another male, and it makes me wonder whether or not we didn't just miss a confrontation between the two of them. The black-bellied bustards have been calling like crazy over the last few weeks. Now, it is breeding season. Their cousins, the red-crested corhans, have also been doing their mating display. Now, it's clearly time to do some wooing of the females, but of course that means chasing other potential suitors away as well. And bustards can actually have quite serious fights. It might be my imagination, but this one actually looks as though it's limping ever so slightly. So I wonder if it didn't come away from that confrontation a little bit the worse for the wear. If it did, then it's probably going to be far more reluctant to call and draw attention to itself. Let me just try and reposition for one last view. I'm really hoping it might call, although we've been lucky with their calls over the last few weeks, and I think perhaps the way our afternoon is going on Cheetah Plains, Bryan, might not happen. It has been very quiet this afternoon. Where'd it go? There it is. There it is, hiding just, it's going to pop out behind that stump. A little bit to the left, there we go. I think it is going to stay quiet and slowly but surely move off into some cover. Bryan, how do you feel about doing a black-bellied impression? Can you do one for us? That would be marvellous, because I don't think this one is going to play along. So perhaps we'll have to get Bryan, who is, of course, a master mimic, to do an impression of a black-bellied bustard call. Clearing the throat. Perfect. It's that pop at the end. That pop at the end makes it. I can't do that. How did you do that? Did you do it with a thumb? No, I'll just make a weird, an odd, slightly sad sound. That was a vague pop. Ow. I was hurting my cheek. No, I don't know how you do that. Obviously, I didn't do this enough as a child. Why can't I do it? Ridiculous. That was so loud. Can I just pretend that was me? No. I just can't do it. Just can't start the car either. There we go. I just can't do it. I just cannot do a black-bellied bustard impression. Herbie also does a fantastic black-bellied bustard impression. I can do a good pearl-spotted owl, but I mean, that's really one of the easiest ones that we get out here. How many of you can do a good black-bellied? How many of you think that you can do a good black-bellied bustard impression? I think I'd like to see it. Once or twice before, we've asked our various viewers to send through their best impressions. I think that one of them was a leopard sawing. I don't remember if Brent ever asked. He did. He did ask for all of your best impressions of leopards mating. So if you could perhaps send us through your best black-bellied bustard. Try saying that five times fast. If you could send through your best black-bellied bustard impressions, that would be truly marvelous. We would very much appreciate that. And you can do that on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And I have gamely attempted to follow suit. I just can't do it. I can't do it. I'm obviously doing something completely wrong. Nope, it's definitely not going to work. Right, I'm going to give up on my, probably a future as a black-bellied bustard imitator is not going to be in my path. But what we're going to do is we're going to go and check Buffle's hook. No, not bubbles of dam, Buffalo Pan, because this is perfect big cat weather. We saw Quarantine here not too long ago, and he was looking a little bit on edge. Quarantine is a male leopard, and on days like today, the big cats are going to be moving about. They're going to be marking their territory. It's nice and cool. All of their urine scent marks have washed away. That is what we are looking for, to see whether or not one of them might decide to pop out. And we are coming up to a short break in the not too distant future. Join us to find out whether or not on this perfect big cat weather day any of them decide to pop out. Who knows, when we next see you we might have a leopard or a lion. Stay tuned to find out. And of course none of you are going anywhere. Bryan, what shall we sell to our audience members today? Have we done the advertising for the shop? If you would like to buy our merchandise, you can, and this is genuine by the way, this is not a made up advert, this is a genuine one. If you would like to potentially help to fund our adventures in other parts of Africa, into other parts of Africa, and get yourself some really cool merchandise, you can have a look at shop.wildearth.tv. I don't know, I've forgotten. Shop.wildearth.tv, I believe. Yes, we'll go with that. And have a look at the various things that we have in store for you, or that quite literally in store for you. And yes, we would really appreciate it. Christmas is coming up. You'll find some lovely collections of mugs and t-shirts and hoodies. And I think I want one. I'm starting to feel like I might need one. And it's a very short-lived offer, so please do join us there. Right, where is Mr. Quarantine? He's off practicing his best black-bellied Bustard impression somewhere. I also did something I've never done before, which is track a wildebeest herd. They went into Mala Mala. I thought perhaps we might try and find them and see whether or not there are any babies with them. But no such luck, sadly. They went south across our boundary, and actually they must have gone so far south that we weren't able to see them anymore in that great open area. Chances of picking up any tracks this afternoon, relatively slim, so we just have to hope that we come around the corner and bump into something and maybe see a tortoise. I'm feeling a little bit left out. I haven't seen a tortoise today. They're one of my favorite things, and they do like enjoy coming out just after the rain. See some tracks in the road, so they are around. Even a tortoise leaves a clearer track than a leopard in weather like this. Their sharp little claws create these almost two tracks. That's not going to be clear enough, unfortunately. Whilst we search for something exciting to show you, so far our Cheetah Plains expedition has been relatively fruitless, but never fear, the day is yet young. I think we'll send you back all the way over to Djuma to Brent.
Okay, we're here. Don't fly, don't fly, don't fly. You sit right there, little birdie. Quite big birdie. Oh, he's flying. It's a Pelmorph Warbirds. It's being mobbed by a lilac-breasted roller. And he's gone. Oh, there, I'm sure we'll check. The roller is back on its perch there. Unfortunately, we can't see those bright colors. Now, it's likely that there's a roller has a nest in that dead knob thorn. It's a very good spot for roller nests, lots of cavities. So that's probably why it didn't like the Warburg's eagle sitting on top. Okay, let's carry on moving. Thank you. Welcome back. We are in the middle of the African bush on your very own live privately guided safari. And normally when you go on a private safari, you only get one guide. Today, you are spoilt. You have four. So we are doing our best to find you the wonders of Africa. Jamie is far down in the east seeing what's happening on cheetah plains. Who knows? A cheetah might pop out. We have been following male lion tracks that have come through here, the second set of male lion tracks, so there's possibly two big males somewhere in this vicinity, and I'm hoping as it gets a little cooler we're gonna get some luck. And of course Stef is getting himself ready for the deluge he's been predicting for the last 3 weeks on bushwalk, showing us how to survive in wet or dry. What to eat, what not to, what you can drink and what's bad for you. I'm going to keep looking for these lions and I'm hoping that they've moved through towards this area here. They have spent a bit of time in this area in the past, but the amazing thing about being on a live African safari is you never know what's around the next corner. We could stumble upon an elephant, a buffalo. And of course, if you want to know more about what's happening out here in Africa, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter and we will answer your questions. Also, remember to tell us where you're from. We love knowing where in the world you might be joining us on the world's largest safari vehicle.